And I'm still with Lisa Genova. She's the author of the book, Still Alice, the basis of the film. How do, for people watching this, how do you recognize the symptoms of someone with Alzheimer's, someone around you? And what do you do?
Okay, well, this is what everyone's terrified of, right?
Yeah.
Because you've probably, within the last day or two, walked into a room and thought, why did I come in here? Mm-hmm. Or where are my keys? Or, oh, you know, what's his name? And so when does it
That's
cross?
That's as normal as can be.
Right. Yeah. So like that tip of the tongue, like, oh, what's his name? The average 25-year-old experiences that 3 to 4 times a week. Mm-hmm. And that does increase as we age. And yet with Alzheimer's, it's something slightly different. So the signs are more like, you can't remember the name, and then you don't have that first letter. Mm-hmm. You don't have the number of syllables. It doesn't then pop into your head in an hour while you're driving down the street. It's not going to come on the tip of your tongue ever.
Mm-hmm.
Keys, you can't find the keys, and when you do, you don't remember what they're for. Or you find them and they're in the refrigerator somewhere mm-hmm. strange. Most of us, when we can't find our keys, it actually isn't a memory problem, it's an attention problem.
Right.
You're doing 5 things at once and you never actually paid attention to where
right.
you put them in the first place.
Right.
So you start experiencing memory impairment that's really drastically different than the kinds of memory impairments that we're used to. Mm-hmm. And
is
you there, recognize
any,
that.
Is there any point where you say to yourself, now I must go see a doctor or get tested? I mean, what did you find from
Well, for everyone, it's different. I mean, a lot of the people that I met with early onset were like Alice, in that sort of the being, knowing that you're lost in a place that is familiar.
Right.
Like, this is a place that I've been to 100 times or 1,000 times or my whole life.
Or the middle of a speech, as we saw, right?
And
where
a word
suddenly,
just drops
yeah.
out. Something that's so out of the norm for you. Is when usually the conversation starts to get real. And for someone young, it's usually not a straight and narrow path to diagnosis mm-hmm. because there are other things that can cause dementia and memory impairment and cognitive problems, and you want to rule those treatable causes out first.
And what about for family members seeing someone or watching someone? What did people tell you that you talked to, and what did you see yourself?
You know, surprisingly, for the people that I know with Alzheimer's, it was usually the people themselves with Alzheimer's that drove the decision to get an answer before other people. I think that
really?
This is such a hard thing to face. Mm-hmm. And internally, you know what's going on better than anyone else. I know that my grandmother probably knew that she had Alzheimer's before we did. Mm-hmm. She was just, she wasn't a complainer, and mm-hmm. she was tough and very... Mm-hmm. Intellectually agile, so she moved around her symptoms in some very mm-hmm. sort of creative ways for a long time. Mm-hmm. But I think people are surrounding someone with Alzheimer's, the people I've seen and had experience with, don't push the process forward. They're happier to retreat and be in denial or look the other way. No one wants this to happen to anyone that they love.
You've continued writing, right?
Yes.
Other works that sort of pick up on the theme, right, of understanding disease and what's happening around us in our lives, but through fiction.
Yeah, so I'm my training's in neuroscience, which is a, you know, kind of a bizarre thing for a novelist. But so I'm using that, and mm-hmm. it's absolutely what I care about and I'm passionate about. So I write stories that are accessible mm-hmm. About people living with neurological diseases or disorders who are ignored, feared, or misunderstood.
And now, what's the latest project?
The book that's coming out in April is called Inside the O'Briens. It's about a blue-collar Irish Catholic family from Charlestown, Massachusetts, mm-hmm. dealing with Huntington's disease. And so Huntington's is a neurodegenerative disease. It's 100% genetic, so if mom or dad have it, each kid has a 50-50 shot of getting it.
Mm-hmm.
I was 22 years old in a neuroscience lab in the Charlestown Navy Yard when the lab down the hall in February of 93... all these, you know, sort of nerdy neuroscientists start screaming and yelling and celebrating. Mm-hmm. They had just isolated the genetic mutation that causes Huntington's disease.
Wow.
And I remember sort of being still and getting that full body chill and knowing that I was witnessing a historic moment in science
yeah.
and thinking, my God, they're going to cure this disease because it's the only thing that causes it.
Yeah.
And we're 22 years later and there's still no treatment and no cure. Part of the issue is that there are only about 30,000 people in the U.S. that have this. So it's called an orphan disease.
Yeah.
If you're a drug company
and you could
go after Alzheimer's, which has 5 million Americans, or Huntington's that has 30,000,
right.
what are you put your investment in. And yet, only one thing causes Huntington's. So it's sort of, it's been called the most curable incurable disease. So I wrote this book in part to raise some awareness and urgency around this disease that isn't paid attention to.
All right, Lisa Genova, thank you very much.
Thank you.